Well, ladies and gents, thank you so very much for coming back to this final session on this, as I'm sure you'll agree, particularly chilly Canberra day, on how Australia, Japan and the US can work with other regional security players. For those of you who don't know me, hi there, my name's Matt Sussex and I'm the Academic Director here at the NSC. And we're particularly privileged to have for this this last session three very, very fine commentators, and I'm sure you know them all very well. But first of all, we'll hear from Dhruva Jashankar, then we'll hear from Gordon Flake, and then after that, we'll hear from David Brewster. Each of the speakers will talk for around about 10 to 15 minutes to maximise time for discussion and Q&A. There is a sense, I think, that people do want to have a little bit more discussion, and hopefully we'll be able to accommodate that this afternoon. Well, without any further ado in that case, I think that I should hand over to Dhruva and let him get us underway.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you to Roy Metcalf, to his colleagues at the NSC. It's a great privilege to be here. Back in Canberra, I was here last month for the first time, and this is my second visit in just 2 months. And it's great to be talking with all of you about US, Japan, Australia cooperation. These are the three countries. I actually have a personal connection with all three of them. I'm from India, but I lived in the United States for over a decade. I lived in Japan for 5 years, and while I'm a relatively recent visitor to Australia in a professional capacity, I actually spent a month here as an exchange student in primary school. So I do have a sort of a personal connection to all three of them. I will be addressing, and I'm sure this will come up more in the Q&A, but I will be using a four-letter word quite a lot, quad. But I will be talking about why the quadrilateral, the US, Japan, India, Australia quadrilateral, why it makes sense, and also lay out why it doesn't make sense, why cooperation is difficult and why it may not happen. But I want to set the stage, and I think I'll be recapping just briefly some of the comments that we've heard over the last few sessions. I think that there's some sort of broad agreement, or just some general observations about the context. Why are we here? Why are we talking about this issue at this time? One is, I think there's a broad consensus that the security order in the Indo-Pacific has become increasingly unstable, that we are in a period of greater competition, that the Indian Ocean region in particular is one where there isn't a strong security architecture. And there is a serious concern that this could become a zone of greater competition between maritime powers. A second reason is, I think we were living under, you can call it an illusion, or we were living under the understanding we were in a positive-sum world, that economics and strategy, economics and security could be advanced on parallel tracks, so we're somewhat independent of each other. And I think that we're now seeing a sort of a slide towards more of a zero-sum world where economics and strategy are becoming more and more aligned. We're not quite there yet, but I think this is a reality that is beginning to dawn on various people at various times. The third, I think, is we have a bit of a vacuum in terms of an entity that is able to establish order. That is, the ASEAN-led order, the ASEAN centrality, is becoming more and more untenable. The conditions under which ASEAN centrality took root were quite specific. There were ones in which all the great powers were either internally focused, great and middle powers in the Asia-Pacific were either internally focused, or were distracted by other considerations, the United States, the Soviet Union, China under Deng Xiaoping, India, Australia, Japan. But those conditions no longer really apply, and we're seeing all the great middle powers now reinserting themselves in various ways into, particularly in terms of, strategically speaking, in the Indo-Pacific. And this is, I think we now have to ask some very serious questions, particularly in the aftermath of the Permanent Court of Arbitration's ruling on the South China Sea, as to whether ASEAN centrality really is tenable in the long run. The fourth observation and final one is that we're seeing a sort of a new security architecture slowly evolve. And this is most apparent in the creation of various triangles, various trilaterals in the region. There's six, at least, that come to mind as six triangles, six trilaterals that meet on a regular basis at a reasonably high level. And they're US, Japan, South Korea, US, Japan, Australia, US, Japan, India, Japan, Australia, India, China, Japan, South Korea, and India, Russia, China. And the interesting thing I think about that is Japan is part of five of those six. So it's in some ways the sort of nodal point for this emerging architecture. So with this backdrop, I just want to speak a little bit then about sort of India's bilateral relations, particularly security relations with the three other actors, US, Japan, and Australia. All have been arguably much better placed today than they were 5 or 7 or 10 years ago. And I'll briefly just discuss why. I mean, I think the US is perhaps the actor that India now engages with in terms of security on the most regular basis. The US and India signed a joint strategic vision for the Asia-Pacific and Indian Ocean region, it's a mouthful, in January of 2015 when President Obama came to India, which, I mean, you know, there was a lot of criticism that this was not a strategic relationship. If you want to put those doubts to rest, please read this text. It's a very short document. It does lay out a sort of a joint strategic vision for the region. Military-to-military contacts are now better than ever. They're more regular. India conducts exercises with the United States more regularly than any other country. Staff talks take place on a regular basis. Military sales, the US is now the second largest provider in terms of value to the Indian armed forces after Russia. For somebody who's observed the relationship for even 10 or 12 years ago, you would not have imagined this was possible. It now is. There's not a lot on the combat side. A lot of this is there's just been a big sale of howitzers that's been agreed, but largely this is in the form of transportation aircraft, and very important airlift capability and so forth. But this has been a very positive development. There's been an ACSA, a logistics support agreement that was signed after 12 years of negotiation almost, but long overdue, but this has been done. So this kind of, I think, sets the backdrop for the US-India relationship. Joint development is the next frontier in many ways, but we're sort of slowly moving in that direction. With Japan, arguably, I would say Japan is now possibly the country that India meets with bilaterally at a political level, perhaps more than any other country. Japan and Russia are the only two countries with which India has annual summit-level meetings. That's the two prime ministers meet alternatively in India and Japan. There's a 2+2 dialogue involving the foreign and defense ministries, which is the only such arrangement India has with another country, is with Japan. The trilaterals, as I mentioned, both the US-Japan-India trilateral and the now India-Japan-Australia trilateral, now take place on a regular basis. Military exercises is another one, particularly in the maritime domain, is another area that has seen very positive developments. Recently, the two countries also signed two important agreements, one related to technology transfers, another related to the sharing of classified military information. And for Japan, the next frontier really is defense sales, thanks in part to Australia, Australia's decision regarding subs, which everyone seems to be referring to, India might possibly be the first buyer of Japanese defense equipment. The India-Australia relationship, security relationship, is perhaps the least developed of the three. And the conditions for that 5 or 6 years ago, I think, were not very propitious. Australia had recently pulled out of the four-letter word again, out of the Quad in 2008. There was some sort of political issues made of attacks against Indian students and Indian citizens in Australia, and there was a uranium ban in place. And I think all three of those issues that kind of tarnish the relationship or the perception of the relationship have all been dealt with in the last few years. So the circumstances are certainly more favorable. The uranium ban has been lifted. Number of Indian students to Australia is still very large and growing. And I think there's now, with the new government, particularly after Prime Minister Modi's visit to Australia in 2014, and his bromance with Tony Abbott, you now have a sort of, in some ways, the two sides turning a new leaf in the relationship. So what is then stopping the four, or even the three for that matter, and I think it applies equally to the trilateral, what is now stopping these? I mean, I think there were some practical reasons given in the last panel, but for me, I think there's sort of three larger conditions. One is, I think we're in a post-alliance age. I'm going to elaborate on each of these. Second, we're in an anti-strategic age. And third, we're in an age of digital nationalism. And the common thread to all of these is that all have to do with the fact that we are all live in democratic societies. So just as democracy is perhaps one of the values that is pulling these actors together, equally it is perhaps responsible for keeping them apart. And I'll just briefly elaborate on what I mean by all of those three things. We're in a post-alliance age. There is, while the US does have alliances of the five in the Asia-Pacific, I think it is quite remarkable that there have been no new alliances formed in the post-Cold War era. All of these are, in fact, legacies of the Cold War. And arguably, not all of them, I mean, perhaps Japan and Australia are the exceptions, but I think serious doubts have been cast in the 90s or 2000s about the other three, certainly, about South Korea, about the Philippines, about Thailand. In large part, it is precisely because of democratization that's become very difficult for two countries, any two countries, to enter into a mutual defense treaty. That is, it requires a commitment on the part of an elected government that citizens of country A will defend and put their lives on the line for country B, and vice versa. And this, again, I think is very difficult to now. I mean, it's all good and fine to have these legacy institutions. I think the region is better off for it, for the US alliances. But entering into new ones is going to be increasingly difficult, and preserving the existing ones will be increasingly difficult. The second issue, we're in an anti-strategic age. And I think I want to echo some of the comments made, I think, by one of the panelists, I can't remember whom, and I think the previous session, I think Ross Babbage, I think, maybe mentioned it. That is, we now in some ways take peace for granted, and this is particularly true amongst millennials. There was a widely circulating survey that was done recently, and I think Australia was one of the countries that was surveyed in this, and they found that, you know, people don't care so much, you know, younger generations don't care as much about democracy as older generations. There's never really been a fear of an alternative. But equally, we all have, I think, sharpening and complicated civil-military relations. In many cases, and it's particularly acute in Japan, where I think you have a very sharp military divide. I mean, military officers in Tokyo don't wear their uniforms when they go in public transportation. Because of fear of how people would react to it. Equally, I think we have an issue in India with a very sharp civil-military divide. And this is obviously getting complicated in places like the United States as well. Elite universities in the US have almost no recruitment to the military now. So as a result, I think there's been a bit of a failure on the part of strategic elites, and I count myself, I suppose, in that camp, in trying to explain why national security is necessary. Why do alliances matter? In some ways, if you see the success of President Trump in the United States, who's questioned many of these underlying beliefs, why does NATO exist? I think a lot of this resonates with people precisely because I think the strategic elites have done a pretty poor job of explaining national security. We consider these things reflexive truths within our own community, but do a very poor job of explaining it outside of our narrow communities. The third condition that I mentioned is the age of digital nationalism. And what this means is really that it'll become increasingly difficult to control escalation during periods of tension. This is what a certain Edward Luttwak wrote 20 years ago about us being in a post-heroic age. And many of those words, he wrote an essay in 95 and a version of it in 96. And he said, today, disputes over minor diplomatic aims or mere posturing for domestic constituencies are enough to provoke reckless displays of bellicosity or imprudence. And I think that resonates pretty strongly today. He was using amongst the examples he was using was the Taiwan Strait crisis in the mid-1990s. But that again is just as equally applicable, I think, to what we've seen more recently in Taiwan, what we're seeing on the Korean Peninsula, what we may be seeing, not immediately, but possibly be seeing hypothetically in between India and China as well. And so I think for all of these reasons, it will become increasingly difficult for these countries, whether the US, Japan, Australia, or India as well, to work more closely towards greater coordination and cooperation, particularly in the security realm. So let me leave it at that. Those are just some thoughts that I had. Hopefully we can continue some of this over the Q&A. Thank you.
Thanks, Drew. Particularly insightful and comprehensive, I think. I must say I was struck by your comment about the emergence of a re-emergence of a zero-sum region. You know, we hear a lot about the liberal order being underpinned by positive-sum interactions or US-led order, however you want to conceptualize it. Led me to think, would we really know what a positive-sum region looked like in the absence of a US-led or liberal order? Would we know what it looked like if it was, say, multipolar or Chinese-led alternatively? So something I'm thinking about anyway. Welcome Gordon to the microphone. He's going to focus on Japan.
Korea. Well, thank you. I'm delighted to be here. As I was flying in this morning, I spent some time trying to think of a well-crafted phrase that would keep you all awake in the last panel of the afternoon. But when I heard Grant Newsham say, cargo cult on amphibiosity, I gave up. There's just nothing I could do that could possibly top that. Instead, I've turned to coming up with a new tourism slogan for Western Australia, where I live in Perth, which is Perth, the farthest point on the planet away from Donald Trump. And I figure if we mark it, we could do pretty well with that. The topic I was given was obviously working with regional security partners, and Rory asked me to focus on a country that I've spent a lot of time focusing on, and that is Korea. And obviously, this is a topic that has new importance after the last 3 months, the transition, the remarkable 8 days of a Trump administration. I just returned today, midday, from a conference in Los Angeles that I was attending with Amy and others entitled U.S.-Australia Dialogue on the Indo-Pacific. You will not be surprised to know that we didn't talk about the Indo-Pacific very much. There was a very huge elephant in the room, which dominated much of our discussions. I'm going to do my best to avoid that today and to focus on the topic at hand, but let me just kind of start by addressing it very briefly, because the transition happening in Washington, and I'll talk about it in the points below, really does render much of the conversation we're having uncertain at best, irrelevant at worst, just because there are so many moving parts. And I've never, many of you here in this room in various parts of your government or academic careers have probably worked on these wargaming exercises, where you sit there and you're chatting along, and then an hour later somebody comes in and just throws in some preposterous change in the war game and everything changes. That's what the last 8 days has been like, right? At least four times a day, there's a new tweet that comes in that just kind of upends some 50, 60-year long standard kind of assumption or truism. And candidly, I can't think of a single issue that's been discussed thus far today that is not uncertain right now. And so again, I don't want to understate that in my focus on the issue today. But having said that, let me return to kind of focusing on the basic idea that after a morning and an early afternoon discussion, which I thought was fantastic, on the potential for real and deepened cooperation between Australia and Japan and the United States, one of the important areas to explore a little bit more deeply is who might those three partner with more effectively in the region. We've got some perspectives about India. I think we're going to hear a little bit more about Southeast Asia as well. But Korea is an obvious candidate. Like Japan, like Australia, allies with the United States. And like Japan, like Australia, very active in the international community, democratic society, market economy, major economy, considerable strategic capabilities. And so it would seem to be an obvious candidate. Now, having said that, I'll begin with a kind of a broad observation, is that Korea has a very different perspective on these issues than does Japan. And I've known this for a long time, but it was driven home to me in spades this past October when I spent just a back-to-back weeks in Korea and Japan. And to state it quite bluntly, Japan has a strategic perspective about Australia. And that is evidenced by Prime Minister Abe's decision to kind of rush his visit here to Canberra, you know, the week before the inauguration, by the repeated phone calls, the meetings, the joint statements, the work together on TPP. And that, I think, is a partnership that is going to be driven ever deeper by those same uncertainties that I was talking about in Washington, D.C. Japan's view of Australia's strategic importance is driven in part by Japan's having a broader view of the region. And by Japan, in this case, I'm really talking about the Abe administration. And again, even in his first term, you know, he had, you know, a clearer vision of where he wanted Japan to go and what he wanted Japan's role in the region to be. So these are very closely tied together. But there are even, you know, security analysts and others in Japan right now that are talking about Japan's Indo-Pacific pivot. Right? Korea, on the other hand, and again, I'll be very blunt here, does not have a view of Australia that is strategic. They're an important partner. It's a close relationship in terms of trade. It's an important one. We have former Ambassador Bill Patterson here that can attest to it in great detail. But you know, they recognize the history. They recognize Australia's role in the Korean War. But other than Australian Korean businesses, they don't necessarily view Australia in that light. Koreans have kind of the U.S. here, China here, Japan off to the side with all the sensitivities that come with that, and then Australia and the rest of the world. It just, they're so consumed by their own, you know, issues, particularly the division of the Korean Peninsula. And candidly, I've done now three different conferences in Seoul in the last 2 years, you know, evangelizing, you know, the Rory Medcalf kind of Indo-Pacific kind of notion. And each one of them is kind of met with great surprise because they do not have an Indo-Pacific strategy. And if you don't have an Indo-Pacific strategy, it's difficult to make the case for Australia in that context. So now, having said that, it's important also to note, and again, not surprisingly, that, you know, while there is at this point an emerging, and I think evidenced by our discussions today, ever strengthening U.S., Japan, Australia, trilateral kind of dialogue, there is no U.S., Korea, Australia trilateral dialogue, let alone a U.S., Japan, Australia, Korea quad, right? The four-letter word, right? Ironically, the only country in which that's probably really a four-letter word would probably be India. India is the one that's kind of averse to the quad, if that makes sense in that regard. But in this context, I thought I would just start off by talking about, you know, four obstacles to a closer cooperation with Australia, Japan, and the U.S., and Korea. And then I'll point out some more positive developments that I think are worth exploring and working on as we go forward. First and foremost, again, is not a surprise to anybody, ongoing Korea-Japan tensions over historical legacy issues that, you know, time after time after time you think are resolved that are not. And so, you know, a year and a half ago you had this historic breakthrough on the ever-sensitive issues surrounding comfort women, and, you know, the instability in South Korean politics means that, you know, with Park Geun-hye having been impeached and the process going through the trial part of that process, there's a throw the baby out with the bathwater phenomenon. So anything that she did is inherently suspect, and you're not going to be surprised to know that includes the deal with Japan on the comfort women. So that final, we've solved this, this issue is put to bed, issue will once again, already is, but will once again rear its head. And you know, there has been some positive developments. We finally got a GSOMIA, a General Sharing of Military Intelligence agreement between Japan and Korea. You know, again, it's kind of a baseline agreement we should have had 20 years ago, but there's been some progress in that front. But those tensions really make this very difficult. And of course, that's very dependent also on what happens on my second point in terms of obstacles, and that is ROK domestic uncertainty. I think everybody in the room here knows what's happening there right now, so I won't go into it in great detail. But as somebody who's watched Korea for over 30 years, I have no idea how this is going to play out. You know, and again, I'm also somebody who on November 8th stood in front of an audience of 450 people in Perth, ever confident that Hillary Clinton was going to win the election, walking around giving very specific vote tallies. And then over the course of 7 hours, you know, all my best friends in Western Australia watched me melt down. And for 2 weeks afterwards would walk up to me in the street and say, "Gordon, do you need a hug?" In terms of regard. So I've got a pretty bad record at picking politics. And certainly it's even more difficult in the case of Korea right now. You have the re-entry in the race of former UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, but has not been overly astute in terms of domestic politics. But one thing I think is pretty clear to me, the relative stability of the Park Geun-hye, Im Myung-bak era in terms of security alliance relationships is over. Yeah? Even if Ban Ki-moon comes in, he's going to have to come in on some very different premises given what's going on in South Korea right now. So it's a really interesting time. And going back to what I said at the outset of this conversation, what just happened in the U.S. does not help this. You know, so the same things that everyone in this room is reacting to and the demonstrators in airports around the world are reacting to are playing out in Korea as well. And it's going to play out in the context of a very difficult, you know, both impeachment process and presumably succeeding presidential election. And not necessarily a good thing to have the U.S. perceived as such in that context, and it won't bode well. So I'm concerned about that. I'm concerned about that trajectory. I'm concerned about the statements that are already being made, and they haven't really gotten off the ball yet in that front. Third obstacle, Chinese opposition. Grant, in listing his list of excuses, included the Chinese won't like it. This is a very important one for Korea, and I've often accused my Korean friends of being more Catholic than the Pope when it comes to the Chinese, you know, thinking about what Chinese would think of before the Chinese have thought about it and acting accordingly. But as of what's happening right now, I don't know how closely you've all followed this, but Korea's decision to move forward with THAAD, you know, Theater High Altitude Missile Defense, has engendered some very serious Chinese opposition and Chinese economic consequences and a major both diplomatic beatdown and now economic beatdown. And so there are consequences, and Korea is facing this, and it's a tough and difficult time. And so you put it in that context where the consequences are real, you can imagine that the Koreans are going to be a little bit gun-shy about moving forward into an open cooperation with U.S., Australia, Japan, Korea. So I just throw that out as another obstacle worth us discussing going forward. And the fourth, and perhaps maybe I should have bumped it up to first, and that is really uncertainty about the United States. Now, it's kind of weird for me, you know, after having spent 25 years here in Washington, to be here talking about U.S. weakness. Because, you know, candidly, whether you're an academic or a think tank or a government official, you could come up here and just talk about the U.S. commitment with tremendous confidence. I just saw, as I walked in here, a moving op-ed by Ambassador Jeffrey Bleich, who was with Amy and I just last week, I think probably after our frightening meeting, felt inspired to write it. But he basically said in his entire career, including time as a U.S. government official, he has never once written a public article criticizing U.S. government policy. But he feels morally bound to do so right now. And so in addition to the long list of issues that are there, I'll throw out an issue that's of real concern to me personally and to Australians in the room right now. And again, this echoes some of the conversations we had. On the professional level, there is a mandate to continue to cooperate on all the full raft of issues that Australia and the U.S. work on, and that Japan and the U.S. work on, and the Korea and the U.S. work on together. At the same time, given that all of our societies are democratic societies, we depend on popular support for those policies. And that has long been taken for granted in Australia. And so it was just striking to me that after we had a really depressing day, then the foreign minister, Julie Bishop, came in and gave just a wonderful, inspiring speech about all the great things that happened. I thought, well, maybe it's not so bad. And then that evening, I turned on my computer and I watched Wali Ali's The Project, and he had like a 5-minute just rant on the 40 things that had happened in the first 8 days, or the first 7 days of the Trump administration at the time. And you can imagine the average punter in Australia seeing that list, and then seeing, you know, a government that's relatively bullish, you can very quickly begin to see daylight in that position on some of these very sensitive issues, particularly sensitive issues which are difficult to explain to the public. So I think in all of our countries, as I referenced in Korea, in Japan, in Australia, we are heading into an area where that is going to be a real challenge for policymakers, and particularly those who haven't had to deal very much with public opinion, to begin to wrestle with going forward. I will throw in a couple of other things that I think are relevant in terms of the U.S.'s role in this process. Number one, people. You know, international relations are about relationships. I think you are all aware that when President-elect Trump, you know, went in the very next week to meet with then-President Obama, he was shocked to find out that there are some 4,000 political appointees that he was responsible, he and his staff, for appointing. And he kind of thought he was just going to waltz in with two or three people and just take over the government as it was. I did a quick count just while I was sitting here in the earlier panel. To the best of my knowledge, thus far he has nominated 109 of that 4,000. Now, again, he doesn't nominate all of them. A lot of them come in, and once the other ones get into place, and that process will flow forward. But when you couple that with the fact that many, particularly in the State Department, where this week we saw five senior civil service officials leave, are not in position, are not being consulted, there is a real risk in terms of that process. And again, it impacts, to restate it, almost everything we talked about today. The last thing I'll talk about on in the U.S. front is that our presumption at the Perth U.S. Asia Center was that under a Clinton presidency, we would be playing offense, right? You know, when she launched our center in Perth 4 years ago, she used the term Indo-Pacific, and so it was all about what can the U.S. and Australia do together. You know, and my guess is when this project or this conference was first conceptualized, that was the presumption. Wow, what could the U.S. and Japan and Australia do together in the region? But we have, bluntly, gone from playing offense to playing defense. You know, and to figure out, all right, what can we do to hold on to the gains we've made? How can we hold on to whatever tentative gains came out of the TPP? How can we ensure that these things don't, you know, upend our fundamental advancement of standards and norms that we've been advocating for so long? So, before I depress everybody too much, let me move on to a few positive developments real quick, then I'll wrap up here since I've been on long. On the positive development, there is a growing, I think, strength to the Australia-Korea relationship, and despite what I was saying earlier, a growing appreciation in Korea about the importance of Australia. And this is really thanks to the efforts of people like Ambassador Patterson. Last year, again, it doesn't get a lot of press, but you know, for the first time, I understand there's an Australian officer, you know, embedded in U.S. forces Korea. You know, actively involved in that process. You know, again, Australia played a very important role historically, and that level is important. I understand there's ongoing negotiations about, you know, something similar to a status of forces agreement, you know, what they call a reciprocal access agreement, which is key. And we heard some great details about the importance of amphibiosity, but obviously you got to start somewhere in that process, and building those types of security ties to augment the already tremendous economic ties between Australia and Korea can only be a good thing. And so those developments are very positive. Secondly, and this is an interesting area which I do not think was ever initially conceptualized in this front, but has potential, and that is MICTA. I think many of you are unfamiliar with it, but there's a middle power grouping, and again, I'm not a fan of the term middle power, but I use it anyway just to say it, of Mexico, Indonesia, Korea, Turkey, Australia. We at the Perth U.S. Asia Center have just finished a major report on that, which will be released later on this week. But you know, over the course of the last 3 years, there's been some tremendous developments in that front, where the foreign ministers who lead this initiative have really developed tremendous habits of cooperation and consultation. And you will not be surprised to know that after being singled out for special love from Donald Trump this week, Mexico is ever more keen on MICTA than it ever has been before, you know, as is Korea in that context. And so this, like many other fora, I think are going to highlight something that's going to have to take place at least in the interim. That countries, you know, we were jokingly talking about the need for a G6 or a G19 or all these different things, but countries are going to need to kind of look to moral leadership, you know, and strength where they can find it as they address issues of concern during periods of instability. And for Australia and Korea in particular, their cooperation in that MICTA forum has already been a tremendous boon to the relationship. And I think it's going to continue to expand dramatically just because I think there is real impetus and drive in Australia. There's certainly greater than ever impetus in Mexico, which actually initiated it, and continuing impetus and drive in Korea, as well as growing appreciation in Indonesia and Turkey in their process. The last 2 points I'll make, and I realize I've gone long a bit here, is one, I think the key to this concept of getting Korea to play a more active role as a partner with Australia, Japan, and the United States in this region really stems on convincing the Koreans to think longer term about their role in the region. And as I said at the outset, Koreans are understandably focused first and foremost on Korean Peninsula issues. But they are, top 12 economy in the world, with tremendous capacity internationally and growing capacity both academically in terms of their government. And they've demonstrated that in spades over the last decade in terms of their hosting of the Nuclear Security Summit and the G20 and their own leadership and drive in terms of MICTA in that context. So in that context, it's just very important to get the Koreans to start thinking while they're focused on the Korean Peninsula itself as a first priority, but also start thinking about what the coming development in the next 25 years is. And again, I will confess, knowing full well that Stephen Smith, who serves on my board as foreign minister, was an evangelist for the Indo-Pacific concept, that Rory has been one of the most effective explainers of it. When I was in Washington, D.C., I made fun of the concept of Indo-Pacific. I thought it was an academic construct that had no utility in real-world planning. Now, where you stand is impacted on where you sit. In Perth now, I love the Indo-Pacific. my grandson, his middle name is Indo-Pacific, as it works out, right? But the reality is that the more I look at things from that perspective, the more I'm convinced of its utility. And this is an area where it has a real utility in terms of security cooperation, because it is only when Korea understands that the economic center of gravity is shifting, southwest. As India continues to emerge, as Indonesia continues to emerge, it goes from 230 million people to 400 million people, and as their economy continues to grow, as Burma comes out of its isolation, as Thailand hopefully stabilizes and Vietnam continues to boom, there's no question about where that trajectory is going. And it's going to a point that really makes that construct ever more important. So if you look ahead for 25 years, there's no question that the defining development of the last 25 years was the growth of China. Assuming that all my first points don't play out and that things return to normal relatively soon in terms of the issues I was talking about earlier, the trajectory that we all hope the world will go in, we'll see that defining development be the defining characteristic of the next 25 years, which is the southwestern shift, the economic center of gravity, the Indo-Pacific. And if Koreans can be made to understand that, it'll be much more effective to do that rather than say, pay attention to Australia. You say, pay attention to the Indo-Pacific, and then, look who's sitting at the fulcrum point of the Indo-Pacific. It's Australia. And in that context, that works very well. And I will also add that the most effective possible motivator for any Korean policy is to tell them the Japanese are already there and they're doing it first. So if you can do that, that'll work very well, right? The final thing I will point out is there is some real areas of shared interest from all four of these countries that should be kind of the centerpiece of these discussions. Obviously, the one that's already there is a shared focus on the DPRK. Given how we responded in the last 2 days to this immigration ban, I'm just prayerful that we don't have a long-range missile test, because there is not the capacity right now to respond to that well on a political level in the United States. But that's an issue where there's got to be really close coordination, cooperation between all of those four countries today in that process. And then obviously the territorial disputes, AZIS issues that impact both Korea and Japan are areas where I think there are real commonalities. So I'll wrap up with that, but I think we've gotten some grist for the mill. Thank you.
Very much, Gordon. I know Rory and I can certainly attest to the relatively narrow or focused ROK strategic concept. We were there last year, also proselytizing the Indo-Pacific, and probably did so on an unfortunate day, because it was on the day that the DPRK hadn't had an earthquake, which was measured in about 20 kilotons, I think it came in. But it does raise questions again about how you can get other actors to reconceptualize their sort of strategic geometries and reimagine what types of arrangements might be possible within the Indo-Pacific space. And it's fortunate, in fact, that David Brewster is going to do precisely that in our last paper for today. So let me hand over to him.
Thanks very much, Matt. So I get the lucky last position today, and I'm going to use the opportunity to range a bit far and wide, although I hope I'm not going to go too far off the reservation. But I'll bring it back how it all relates to essentially the Australia-US-Japan relationship. So in recent years, Australia's being really forced to re-examine the regional order that's been in place for the last 70 years and think about new strategic geometries that need to be put in place. And this is obviously being driven by the rise of China, the emergence of India, but now also some signs at least that the US may be looking to renegotiate or reposition its role in the region. And this last factor, the role of the US in Asia, makes it ever more important that Australia and other US allies, such as Japan, take a proactive role in determining what they want the region to look like and how we envisage the continuing role of the US in the region. And we can't just wait for the next tweet from Washington. We really need to be proactive in thinking about this. And on the one hand, you could characterise this as potentially a form of hedging, but I would prefer to see it as proactively searching for a sustainable regional security architecture, one that works for us, for other major powers in the region and the United States. And in order to do this, particularly in light of the uncertainties in Washington, which I expect are going to be continuing for really quite some time to come, I think we really need to take a multi-track approach in pursuing several alternatives at the same time, and particularly those directly involving the United States. We really have little way of knowing whether or not one alternative or another will work for the United States. But I think we should necessarily need to try and work on several tracks. Now, as we know, since the end of the Pacific War, the regional architecture has really been characterised by a series of bilateral treaties between the United States and its Asia-Pacific allies. And while these remain fundamental to Indo-Pacific security, it's pretty clear that these are no longer sufficient in themselves to address issues in the changing order. And this has spurred the creation of new and more complex strategic geographies or geometries. And one trend is towards closer relationships between US allies, joining the spokes, if you like. Another is in developing closer linkages between US allies and others outside the US alliance system. And a third related to that is the development of what's known as these minilateral security dialogues, small informal groupings of countries with similar interests. And as Dhruva enumerated earlier on, there's a whole bunch of particularly of trilateral dialogues. I'm not going to name them all because it's really quite a long list. It's longer than most people would realise. But clearly the most successful of these has been the Australia-Japan-US trilateral dialogue in the 2+ format, which has been incredibly successful. Probably its biggest element of success has been in helping to draw Australia and Japan together. Now, these multilateral dialogues are not just in the US strategic orbit. They're also, I think you could call the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, for example, as being a minilateral security dialogue, and China is also involved in one or two others. India also has been making initial moves to develop its own minilateral groupings in the Indian Ocean. And these groupings fill a space between the bilateral and the multilateral. And hopefully bridge the gap in some ways. And they can, particularly for US allies, they can provide an important symbolic message to China of shared concerns of the participants, and also give the participants possibly the potential to work together to help shape US strategic behaviour. And that's going to become increasingly important over the next 4 years. And some of these arrangements could even evolve into what's being called federated defence systems, where countries cooperate and contribute particular capabilities. And that's really potentially quite attractive to the United States, where it can leverage its high-end capabilities in extending its influence through maintaining a low cost and small footprint. Anyway, that's something that's possibly somewhere down the track. And while some fear that these groupings could potentially create a security dilemma for China, Others really see them as a sort of a soft form of hedging. And the line between that was really, I suppose, best demonstrated by the fate of the quadrilateral security dialogue in 2007 in the face of reactions from China. Now, if you recall, that was the Quad was proposed by Prime Minister Abe in 2006, and it was connected with an expansion of the Malabar naval exercises to include, as well as US and India, Japan, Singapore and Australia. Now, China reacted very negatively to this grouping, and in fact, all four putative partners of the Quad made steps to back away from the grouping, most particularly India, the Indian government under fire from its leftist coalition partners, sort of backed away from the Malabar exercises, and our own Prime Minister Kevin Rudd really did us no favours by very publicly pulling out of the Quad in circumstances which really sent a lot of bad messages. But this the failure of the Quad, or the falling apart of the Quad, if you like, is really being questioned now, and there is a lot of discussion among the four powers, the four maritime powers, of its potential reconstitution in one form or another. But there still remains considerable hesitations about establishing a new Quad. The experience of 2007 has encouraged a view among some that four is bad, three is good, in terms of reactions from China, that somehow or other China will accept trilateral security groupings but not quadrilateral security groupings. It's a theory which I don't know how rational it is, but nevertheless I think it still has quite some sway in some places, particularly Delhi. I think of the four potential partners of the Quad, probably Australia and India are both the most cautious about it, and most prefer to take a graduated response in terms of building the four-way relationship in response, as an incremental response to actions by China, if you like. And I think that view is probably expressed by many, both in Canberra and Delhi. But that doesn't mean that less controversial steps can't be taken. I think it's important that, for example, that Australia be included in the Malabar naval exercises in one form or another, whether or not as a full participant. And I think that there's a lot that can be done in terms of building 1.5 track, more 1.5 track dialogues among the four partners. Not to do so, I think, can be seen as sending the wrong message to Beijing about its ability to veto other relationships in the region. I'll just say a few words now about India and ways that India can be built into the regional order other than the quadrilateral. Now, as most of us probably know, Prime Minister Modi has taken a much more open approach than previous Indian leaders towards security relationships with other countries. And while India still aspires to what it sort of calls strategic autonomy, there seems to be a less narrow view of actually what strategic autonomy means and how it might ultimately be achieved. But while India is progressively leading more and more towards the US strategic orbit. It's not yet clear exactly how India can be or would be prepared to be connected into the US security order in a way that allows it to maintain its strategic autonomy, whatever that is, but probably more importantly, in a way that adds and doesn't subtract to its leverage with China. There's still a lot of caution in Delhi, in my view, about moving the India-US security relationship beyond the bilateral. And Delhi still remains instinctively cautious about any multilateral security relationships to which the United States is a party. And the one exception to this, and not necessarily a fully rational exception, is any relationship that includes Japan. So we have, for example, the India, US, Japan trilateral relationship in which India is a very keen partner. On the contrary, India is really quite cautious and skeptical about entering into a trilateral Australia-US-India relationship. And they're not, in my view, there's not necessarily a completely rational response to that. I think the instinctively Indians would see a trilateral involving US and Australia as somehow incorporating itself into the US alliance system, where Delhi would not see the same vis-a-vis a Japanese trilateral. And there are other factors at play, I think, in Indian thinking, which makes it difficult to treat Australia as a peer partner in the region. And so that's another reason why Australia would be cautious about that sort of trilateral relationship. However, I think that there's still a lot of scope for operational cooperation between the three partners, particularly in the Indian Ocean. India, US and Australia are, you know, among the three biggest players in the Indian Ocean, and increasingly Japan will become an important part of that mix as well. There's also potential to establish minilateral dialogues with a number of other partners, and that's really should be seen as almost as an important part of these new strategic geometries, particularly with partners that currently lie outside of the US security sphere. And this includes, for example, the potential for an India, Indonesia-Australia dialogue, or an upgraded dialogue, or even India upgrading India, Vietnam, Japan discussions. Also, an India-France-Australia dialogue would be an important element for naval cooperation in the Indian Ocean. They're just some examples, but you can put together a lot of other triangles. Importantly, we should be thinking about how to maximise our comparative advantages in terms of relationships. Obviously, countries like Australia and Japan have extremely good relationships with countries within, more or less within, the US strategic orbit. India has very strong relationships with countries outside that orbit. And so it's a matter of mixing and matching and trying to maximise the benefits from all of those relationships. In particular, arrangements that connect with but do not necessarily include the United States, I think would be consistent with important elements of Australia's relationship with India. Australia has very strong interests in seeing the continuation of US strategic predominance in Asia in the long term. But to the extent that changes in the regional balance of power will occur over time, and of course they will, it's also in Australia's interests and Japan's interests, I would say, to see the development of a multipolar system in the Indo-Pacific region that includes a strong and democratic and friendly India sitting at the top table. So I think probably, you know, for that reason, India has to be a focus, and I see the India relationship very much in terms of a shared project potentially between Australia and Japan and the United States. Thank you.
Thanks very much, David. Well, folks, I make it around about a bit over 30 minutes for questions, so we do have a fair bit of time. Can I ask for them in the usual way? And Paul Dibb had his hand up well before anyone else, so I'll go to Paul first.
Thank you, Matthew. If I may, with your indulgence, a comment and then a proposition to put to the panel. We've scarcely mentioned Russia in passing, and although I would argue, as Matthew knows, that it's not a great regional power, it is a great nuclear power, and it has been authoritarian and aggressive. What does the panel think about, yet in another eternal Trumpian question, is Trump really going to have a friendly relationship with this nasty, aggressive, authoritarian power called Russia? Is he going to have an alignment? After all, he's got a Secretary of State who has the Order of Friendship, which, Matthew, in the old days, you and I would have called the Order of Lenin. What would it matter for Australia? Well, it would matter a great deal. The alliance that we have with the United States is not only about common interests, it's about values. We have no common interests with a Russia that is threatening the integrity of Ukraine, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and Poland. But it's a non-democratic country without a free press, without an independent judiciary. No common values, Mr. Trump. The second one is the geopolitics of Southeast Asia. As many people in this room know, Southeast Asia is crucial to our defense security. A friendly, stable, cooperative Southeast Asia is a shield to our northern approaches. The opposite of that, a Southeast Asia that is effectively a Chinese sphere of influence, or if you don't like that Cold War term, a set of tributary states, is decidedly not in our strategic interest. And I would argue, and many of you in this room will disagree with me, I think, that what we're seeing with China is effectively detaching significant parts of Southeast Asia into at least a sphere of influence. And let's look at Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, and increasingly the Philippines, and I would argue Malaysia. That doesn't leave us with much. It leaves us with a Myanmar that's going through enormous change, and the crucial relationship with Indonesia, Singapore, and Vietnam. I guess my question is, what, if anything, can we do about this? And we should be able to do something with the United States and Japan to try and head the Chinese off and make Southeast Asia more attractive to the liberal international order. It's not an easy question, I recognize that, not an easy question at all. And I'd welcome any views any of you have on, does Trump even know where Southeast Asia is, or does he care? I might just in closing say that, in case you think this is some academic question, I have represented Australia for 10 annual meetings of an ASEAN regional forum group that looks at preventive diplomacy. And there's limits to what I can say in public, because I'm chairing the meeting in Australia next month of 27 countries. Are we making great progress? Absolutely not.
Okay, so gentlemen, so Russia, Southeast Asia, I'll let you take them as you like. Gordon?
Yeah, I'll just start. Others can take it as well. Is this working? Can you hear me? Russia, the answer is no. There is not going to be a partnership. There is not going to be a new relationship. The one area where I'm actually relatively confident at the willingness of the gutless wonders known as the Republican Party to resist Trump is on this issue. And so you had over the weekend, again, it's been obscured by the fact that there's been 50 other kind of absurdist things happened, but there was a phone call between Donald Trump and Vladimir Putin. There was signals given early on in the week that things that were on the table included kind of lifting the sanctions on Russia, to which, you know, John McCain and Lindsey Graham put out a statement that said basically, if you do that, we will codify them into law. And there's been very few things on which Mitch McConnell and Paul Ryan have been willing to speak out on, and this is one of them. The second point on that is that the other shoe has not dropped. There are a stream of ongoing intelligence operations going on this front, where the first casualty will likely be Mike Flynn, you know, the current National Security Advisor, and I think that would happen relatively soon. He's already largely been cut out just in this first 8 days with Steve Bannon going in there too. And given his real exposure on this issue, I think it's going to be interesting to see that plays out. So among all the issues that I'm worried about, you know, Russia is not the number one in this region. Obviously, if I was a Europeanist and we're talking about what's going on in Europe, I'd be in a very different perspective. In terms of Southeast Asia, the best way to describe what's happening in Southeast Asia is not anything direct, like it might be with a bilateral relationship with China or direct in terms of the threat to Mexico, but it's really the opportunity costs, right? We went from, you know, the potential for a continuation of a real appreciation, not only of Asia, but remember the U.S. rebalance towards Asia was also a rebalance within Asia. And candidly, I'll admit that it kind of faltered at least in the State Department in the last 4 years, but there was every reason to assume there would be a real reinvigoration of that focus on Southeast Asia. And so if you look at what we're not going to have, obviously the loss of the TPP is huge on that front. You know, Indonesia had expressed its interest, Korea had expressed their interest. You know, for countries like Vietnam and Malaysia that really put heart and soul into this and took tremendous domestic risks, it just sets you back just stunningly. And so, you know, as time goes on, more and more we're going to be thinking about what could have been, you know, had we not gone in a very different direction. And in this regard, I think really there is a growing imperative for countries that are like-minded, like Australia and Japan, throw in Canada, South Korea, whoever else you can get in the front to reinforce those issues. The good thing is you're absolutely right. I mean, there has been almost no statement about from the Trump either campaign or transition or now administration in Southeast Asia. They haven't focused on it. I think it's a good sign that Secretary Jim Mattis is going first this next week to Korea and Japan. Would love to see some good signs about Southeast Asia, but given the 40 other things have been thrown up, there's probably too much to expect at this point. That is a good sign in terms of the defense side. The trade side's all down at this point. I have heard two very different things about whether or not that third leg of the rebalance, which is the political leg, attending the East Asia Summit, attending APEC, is going forward. So whether I have a hard time imagining a President Donald Trump at APEC in Vietnam or at you know, the East Asia Summit in the Philippines.
He'd wear whatever shirt was given to
him. So maybe, you know, there's a lot I haven't been able to conceptualize before, but we'll see.
I just want to touch quickly on some of those points. I mean, actually, interestingly enough, Trump's personal investment in Indonesia is quite striking. He has several properties there, which I'm not sure how, if at all, that will factor into things. But I think it's perhaps good news that ASEAN and Southeast Asia have not been mentioned today, because every country that has been, Mexico, Russia, has been a problem. The second, just a couple of points on from an Indian perspective. I think there is a recognition on the part of the Indian government that it needs to engage more seriously with Southeast Asia. This has not happened in a very systematic manner. They have now sent an ambassador to ASEAN. There's a lot more bureaucratic emphasis on ASEAN as well. There's the annual India-ASEAN summit. This year we'll be celebrating the 25th anniversary of India-ASEAN relations. There'll be several big meetings. But in fact, actually three relationships really stand out from India's point of view. One is Singapore, which is a very important investor and a security partner, actually. The second is Vietnam, which is primarily a security relationship between particularly a maritime relationship. And the third now is Myanmar, which is a neighbor, and India's always had a very sort of complex relationship with Myanmar. One recent development is that there is an organization called BIMSTEC. It started off as a Bay of Bengal initiative, but it now includes Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Thailand, and India. India is now, just this last year, been trying to put a bit more, they had a leaders summit in India on the sidelines of the BRICS summit. And part of this is motivated by the opening up of Myanmar and the opportunities it brings with them. I think we will start seeing a bit more engagement, what form that takes. One thing I think that's important to note is Japan is actually a very important partner of India in working in Southeast Asia. And there's a great deal of coordination now between India and Japan on Myanmar in particular, but also other parts of Southeast Asia where working together. Finally, on Russia, India has a very sort of long-standing relationship with Russia. It's the largest defense provider. Still, it's becoming more and more of a mental transactional relationship. There's not a whole lot of, even though the two leaders meet every year, there's not a whole lot of warmth. You don't really have you don't have Indian students going there, you don't have Indians learning Russian, you don't have, things like that, which you did have a decade or two ago. So it's become a very defense-heavy relationship. There were concerns in India about sort of course, Crimea and MH17 and so forth, but India has sort of largely held its fire. I think the primary concern in India is about Moscow becoming a subordinate partner to Beijing. And this has very real implications for India in terms of its defense relationship. Russia's already effectively lifted a sort of unilateral arms embargo in Pakistan, so there are very serious concerns there. It's interesting that some of those concerns, once again, are shared by Japan about an overly close relationship between Beijing and Moscow. So you saw, for example, when Abe tried repeatedly first just before Crimea when he went to Sochi, and then afterwards trying to reach out to Russia, particularly, I think, several European countries and to a lesser extent the United States were not very happy with that outreach. But there is actually a great deal of alignment in how Japan and India are looking. I think it's quite notable that in 2015, both Prime Minister Modi and Prime Minister Abe visited all five Central Asian republics on a single, they almost did sort of copy. Abe actually went later, so I suppose Abe copied from Modi. I think that's quite significant as well.
I'll resist the urge to weigh in on Russia, with the exception of the observation that it's not just others who are worried about the closeness of the relationship between Moscow and Beijing. It's actually Moscow as well, mm-hmm. and particularly the potential for a subordinate role. What I might do is conscious of the time, so I might run three questions together. One. Two, yes, sir. And John at the back, three.
Thank you, Matthew. Miles Cooper again. I think it's great that we're focused on India and on Korea and how they might relate to the Australia, Japan, United States objectives for security in the region. But I very much share Paul Dibb's concerns about Southeast Asia and the way China is insinuating itself into the region and becoming, I think it's asserting itself with the ambition of becoming the regional hegemon. Now, it may not be so easy to get Australia, Japan, and the US to work together in Southeast Asia, particularly in the coming period, as the new US administration settles down and sorts out its relationships with various other major players in the world. But I think there is scope for Japan and Australia to work in the region, not necessarily together, because I don't know if, as a double act, we would be that effective, but really in a complementary way and in a way that's deliberate and considered on the part of both of us, in a way to enhance the resilience and independence of countries in the region, so that that large slab of regional security is not just left bare and open. So I don't know if any of the panel feel that there are specific things that Australia and Japan could usefully do together in the Southeast Asian region. Thank you.
Thank you for your briefing. I'm Colonel Marabe, I'm military attaché for Embassy of Japan. I have a question. Thank you for your briefing. I understand the three countries, Australia, Japan, and United States, to work together with other regional security players like India or some other countries. But I have a question about what do you think about the incentive from for India to join this kind of trilateral cooperation or what the quadrilateral cooperation, because India, particularly India, has a non-alliance policy. So how to say that? But how they can do you think they make the India involve this kind of framework to, for example, to contribute to the peace and stability or thus how to say security in this region? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Also, thank you for those presentations. John Blackson here from SDSC. I'm just finding it's a little bit connected to what Miles Cooper was asking about before. But I'm struck by how little we've talked about ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. We've talked a little bit about individual players in that space. But all of us are all spying in ASEAN-related forums. The ASEAN Defence Ministers Meeting Plus, we all play in that space. There's a number of activities that are taking place in the ASEAN context that are actually quite constructive. And it strikes me that this is a space in which India, Japan, Australia, the United States and others have been and can continue to play a very constructive role. My sense is that we actually need to take that up a notch and really try to invigorate that. And when you think about that space, particularly from Australia's point of view, it is our immediate neighbourhood. Japan is not, India is not, China is not. Southeast Asia is. And it is in and through that space that our security challenges have always emerged. And yet, it seems we fly over it, you know. We happily fly over it. And yet we really can't afford to keep doing that. I'm wondering if the panel could just comment on that a little bit.
I might ask David to come in first on non-alignment and quads, and then we can broaden out.
Okay, I'll try and answer a couple of questions. I think there's a huge number of opportunities for cooperation or at least coordination between Japan and Australia in the Bay of Bengal region, and I'm particularly thinking about countries like Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Myanmar. Japan is actually really surprisingly active in those countries in terms of building infrastructure and investment, and it really hasn't gotten a lot of play. It's almost to the level of China's One Belt, One Road initiative in other countries. And I think that's very much in coordination or with the agreement of India. And I think Australia also can play a very important role in a number of those countries, in particular niche capabilities, building capabilities, not just physical infrastructure capabilities, but governance capabilities, for example. And I think that can be done in loose coordination with both Japan and India. In terms of the Quad and security relationships, what's in it for India? It's a very simple answer, and that is leverage over China. You don't have to go any further than that. That's what it's about. And the question for India is, will any particular step in terms of moving itself closer to Washington or Tokyo or even Canberra, will that give it more leverage with China or not? And there may be a particular level, optimum level of closeness, not too close but not too far away. But I think certainly the experience that Delhi has seen over the last 5 years or so is the best way to get Beijing's attention is to do something with the Americans, and that's when the Chinese sit up and start paying them a lot more respect than they would usually give.
I would actually take it a little bit farther than David, which is there's a bit of a myth about non-alignment. I mean, it's a myth in India about non-alignment, which is that India's non-aligned. And India hasn't been non-aligned since 1971 and possibly not since the 1960s. Between 1971 and 1991, India was, for all intents and purposes, in the Soviet bloc, it was very much aligned one way. The what's happened, I mean, I think now people use it as a, and some people in India use non-alignment basically as a code word for anti-Americanism. It's a little bit more, it's not much more than that. But India, things have moved and circumstances have changed, and I don't think you'll see a lot of people wedded to non-alignment. The current prime minister doesn't use it at all in any of his public comments, nor do any leaders. I would say there's, you know, India does have serious security concerns. It has, with regards to China, with regards to, and you know, I mean, freedom of navigation is important. There is a border dispute with China, and it's not a small border dispute. This is over territory the size of, well, if you look at all the territorial disputes together, it's about the size of Vietnam, a population of 2 million people. So it's not insignificant. There are deep concerns about One Belt, One Road, as strategic implications of it. So I think if you take all of these together, what can India do about it? One is internal balancing. India can grow faster. That would be nice. India could play a bigger role in Southeast Asia, as I mentioned earlier. And then I think the other thing you can do is partner with like-minded countries, not just as leverage, but also with, you know, possible steps towards interoperability for various contingencies. And you know, HADR is a great example. I mean, you saw in 2004 after the tsunami in the Indian Ocean, India, Australia, Japan, and the U.S. have organically come together to help to provide relief in the Indian Ocean region. So I think there is a very clear logic to what India has in it. I think there are certain caveats as well. I think India doesn't think it's reasonable to be in an alliance for the reasons I articulated. And so it's not simply just a sort of ideological, there isn't just an ideological logic to it. Just quickly on ASEAN, I think a lot more is often made. Three things, I suppose. One is I think we need to stop equaling, Southeast Asia does not equal ASEAN and ASEAN does not equal Southeast Asia. There are 10 countries in Southeast Asia that are ASEAN members, but they are, I think we need to be sort of clear about, you know, ASEAN does some things, and it does conference building measures, and the ASEAN plus ADMM plus ARF East Asia Summit are very useful for that. But I think to think of it as anything more than that is not what ASEAN was made for, and I don't think we should be putting unrealistic expectations on as to what it can deliver. If it can deliver a statement on the South China Sea, I'm not sure we should be asking much more. The other thing I think that's also interesting, the reason why I think we all sort of have overlooked it in a way, is not only is the ASEAN countries sort of surprisingly not active in these emerging minilaterals that we've all talked about, but partly it's because there's pressure that a lot of ASEAN countries face, saying, you know, why are you doing this by yourself? Why aren't you bringing in other ASEAN countries into it? But the other reason is simply a lack of capacity. If you look at, take all 10 ASEAN member countries together, their defense budgets are less together than India's. It's less together than Japan's. And so, in terms of maritime domain awareness, they don't really have the capabilities that, you know, the other members of the erstwhile Quad do have. So I think there is a reason. It would be very nice. I think we would all welcome it if Indonesia played a much bigger role. It would be very welcomed, but I don't sense there's an appetite for that in Jakarta, but I might be wrong.
Just a couple of real quick points. First and foremost, in terms of Japan, Australia cooperation in Southeast Asia, I would think if there's one takeaway from what I thought was a really good day's discussion, it's that the scope for and the mandate for the expansion of that cooperation is obvious. It, given both the concerns about China and concerns about the US in that point, right? And Australia has some tremendous diplomatic and defense capabilities that Japan doesn't in this region. Japan has some tremendous economic equities, trade investment, the things that Australia doesn't have to the same degree in that region. And so the scope for kind of coordination and cooperation, I think, is tremendous. And it can be done on a country-by-country basis, and I think it should be expanded dramatically. I think that we've seen some pretty good indications of that proclivity just in the last few weeks. I think the Prime Minister Turnbull, really handled at least the first phase of the TPP withdrawal quite well. The joint statement with Japan, the clear declaration that Australia is not the United States,
You know, even though there's not a snowball's chance in hell of the TPP going forward now, you know, for Australia to say this is in our interest and these are our principles and we're going to stick by them and we're not going to abandon them just because Donald Trump said so, it was a useful message to the region. And again, it opens the door, and it keeps the door open, rather, for a lot of things going down the pike, depending on how things develop going forward. Ironically, when it comes to India, a lessened U.S. emphasis in the region, probably easier for them. You know, I was joking earlier about some allergy to the word quad in India, but there's less of that in terms of cooperation with Australia, less of that in terms of cooperation with Japan. In fact, in general, Australia is in a really interesting period where I think that over the next 2 or 3 years, you're going to see Australia's relative currency in this region increase quite dramatically. They're an ally of the United States, a very close ally of the United States, with a close cultural, political, security affinity. And you know, at this point, every country in the world is just freaking out, trying to figure out how to understand what's going on, what's going on. And in that context, Australia, which is, you know, both in terms of trade, Australia has a trade deficit with the United States. It hasn't been targeted by Trump for anything at this point. In terms of the alliance relationship, it's very transactional in terms of security and defense. They're kind of the model ally. And in that context, Australia has the potential to, you know, serve as at least a point of interest for a lot of the countries in the region, and with less sensitivity than the United States has at this point. The final point I'll make, though, is I don't want to overstate what I think I probably have in terms of my concern about the U.S. withdrawal from the region in the vacuum. I didn't want to give that impression. We've got Amy here who can give me clear views from defense. But yeah, among the three legs of that rebalance towards Asia, clearly we're going to have some real issues on the diplomatic leg. And unquestionably, we already have major issues on the economic leg, which is the TPP. You know, defense is a much bigger ship, and it moves much more slowly. And so throughout that entire military establishment, there are long-standing, long forward-looking plans and procedures in place and commitments in place. So I don't anticipate there'll be any dramatic shift in terms of U.S. defense commitment to the region. If anything, you know, the one area of unfortunate attention and focus on South China Seas means that tension that you're always writing, if you're in Washington, between reassuring partners and allies in the region enough, you know, to not being so provocative that they get fear of a conflict, that tension, you know, is going to continue, and we'll see how it plays out given the current crew in Washington.
I'll put one to the panel. Oh, well, first, Gordon, you're not the only one that picked the politics wrong, and you're not the only one that needed lots of hugs afterwards, so yes. I'm with you on that one. I'm just wondering, you know, like somebody earlier on in the piece eloquently said that domestic politics played a big deal in the US elections. So there was an internal focus, and I'm just wondering if the panel have any opinion that this might play a bigger part with other countries starting to do the same thing and look internally instead of you know, continuing with the collaboration and carrying on with what our discussion was all about today.
Let me just ask a question right up front, and then I'll elaborate briefly and then leave it to you if you want to make a comment or answer. The question really is, have we understated today the moving dynamic in the regional economies? We've talked quite a lot about TPP, but I'm not sure that we've really come to grips with the dynamic that we're really seeing underway in terms of changing economic dynamics across the region. Let me just give you a couple of examples. My personal view is the Chinese economy is in really serious problems. I talk and have a separate network which talks to investment analysts and senior people in Hong Kong. And I think there's almost unanimous view that there is likely to be very serious problems that are going to become much more evident in the Chinese economy, and that's going to have political and downstream effects. There are already serious strains, not only in debt levels, but in other things in restructuring the Chinese economy. I won't elaborate now. Secondly, a lot of other people in the region already changed. It was mentioned earlier about Japanese foreign investment. in China. But in fact, in recent years, the last two or three years, Japanese foreign investment in ASEAN is more than double what's going into China. And in fact, as you would, I'm sure, be well aware, there's a lot of investment coming out. And even in this town, there is some detailed modelling, and not here, but also in Washington, about looking forward in the regional economies and trying to take a risk assessment. If you look at that, there's a bit of a debate running that in perhaps 25 years' time, which is a long way to look out, Australia's trading relationship with India, when you look at where the Indian economy is going, and you look at where the Chinese economy is going, Australia's trading relationship with India may be stronger than it is with China. So these things, I know there's a lot of moving parts, but do you think we've taken enough account of some of these possibilities? I'm not saying they're certainties.
Since I've been kind of Dorothy Downer for the bulk of this panel, let me end that kind of a vote of optimism, right? There is no question that this is an unsettling time for democracies around the world. And again, we're wrestling with some big meta trends in terms of information and media and technology and wealth gaps. And so you can look country by country, there's some form of this taking place. But I feel compelled to kind of push back very strongly against the notion that what you've seen in the United States is somehow Brexit on steroids, or what's happening in France and these other places, or what happened in Italy in terms of the void. And just to give that little bit of context, you know, the US, you know, because we don't have compulsory voting, has some problem with voter turnout. This election, only 58% of the eligible electorate voted. Of that 58%, only 45% actually voted for Trump. And if you consider the fact that a poll done immediately after the election asking them, did you vote for Trump or against Hillary Clinton? You know, 55% of those voters said they voted against Hillary Clinton, not for Donald Trump, which means that the percentage of the U.S. electorate who actually supports Donald Trump and his positions is about 13%, not too far off Pauline Hanson, right? You know, and so this notion somehow that we have to take into account this America that has rejected its ideals is wrong. You know, we just have a system, and it was exploited, and we were caught unawares, and there was a lot of mistakes made and a lot of blame to go around. But in the end, you saw the day, one day after the inauguration, 4.9 million women march. It is the largest single political act in American history in terms of a demonstration like that, right? In 914 different cities. And you've seen, again, in the course of 8 days, a coalition in the media that just didn't exist before, the courts, just in the last 40 hours have set up. So I'm actually relatively optimistic, more so than I've been for the last 3 years. There is this sense of, you know, awakening. And in the U.S., you know, we see pendulum swings, right? So we'll see. There's a long, bumpy process ahead, and I have no idea how it's going to play out. But I do have a relative sense of optimism. And I do think that, again, we shouldn't write all these things off. If you look at the underlying fundamentals, there's still, again, it's too early to declare the story over. The broader questions, you're spot on. We haven't paid nearly enough attention to China's inherent weakness. You know, I moved to Australia 3 years ago, and I moved to Western Australia, where just because of the dependency of that city and that state on China and iron ore, you know, if you suggested anything, you know, related to potential weakness in China, it was just, you know, inconceivable. You're whistling past a graveyard, and that expression, right? You couldn't talk about it. You know, I came out of a strategic environment in Washington where most of my friends were more concerned about Chinese weakness and strength. And ironically, if you look at what's happening, you know, over the last 2-3 years now with Xi Jinping, you know, his consolidation of power, I also see these things as more indications of weakness and strength. And so while on the one hand, I'm deeply worried about the U.S. own goals, right? You know, just the collapse of the U.S. credibility, the ceding of the ground on the Trans-Pacific Partnership and a long range of issues. I am not overly worried that China is poised to take full advantage of that just because of their own internal domestic issues and weaknesses. And as to your broader point about India, again, obviously, all these things are contingent upon trends which are hard for us to see right now. But I would point out one interesting point. We did, and we're about to do our second round of it jointly, a survey of public opinion within the region, and one of the areas which is quite remarkable, more so than any other country in the region that we surveyed, Australians, when looking longer term, have a much more bullish view in terms of the future of India. You know, so when we ask the question, in 10 years, which country will be the most influential in Asia? 13% of Australians said India, yeah, which was stunning.
I should start off with the premise that I'm not an economist, I'm not a China watcher, which doesn't prevent me from having an opinion about this. I do spend a lot of time talking to people who do, both in the private sector and economists in various governments, sort of who do follow this much more closely. And I mean, many people will say with some degree of confidence that they believe the Chinese economy is actually growing at something closer to 3%. Despite the official figures, that there's a massive bubble that's just waiting to burst. And I think I remember having a conversation with some planners at the beginning of 2016, and we were trying to look at black swans, and the three that we looked at were Brexit, Trump, and a Chinese economic meltdown. Two of the three have happened. Now, that being said, I think we have consistently underestimated the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party's ability to manage problems. Whether this may be a much sterner test than they've ever had to face, and we'll have to see. Polls still show a significant confidence in the CCP's ability to manage things, polls within China. I think one of the key things we often overlook is the resilience of a country. A resilience is really the real key test is how does a system adapt to very adverse circumstances? And we've not had to see that in action since 1989 in China. So I think that this is a big question. On a related note, I do think, and I think you brought it up very clearly in your presentation, what are our strategic goals? And I think we tended to use, the phrase that people used to use was, we need to manage China's rise, quote unquote. And that was often seen as a euphemism for containment. I know a lot of Chinese saw it that way. I think there was actually much more to it than that. The fact is, every single one of us in this room has benefited from China's rise, directly or indirectly. And so why is it that we have concerns about it? And I think there are really four reasons. One is it's not a market economy, it's a mercantilist economy. The second is it's not always a norm abider on freedom of navigation, on non-proliferation. It's a rule breaker. It is not a status quo power. It's a revisionist power at the South China Sea, in Taiwan, elsewhere. And it's an opaque political system, not a transparent political system. So I think what we would like to see is a successful China. I think I would imagine all like to see this, a successful China that is more a market economy, is more transparent, is status quo oriented, and a norm abider. And how do we get to that stage? And that really would require a soft landing, if you will. But I don't get the sense that Xi Jinping's economic or political reforms are moving China in that direction. I think they're trying to on the economic side, they're not necessarily succeeding. On the political side, they're moving in the opposite direction. And so I think we're not anywhere closer to a soft landing than we were 5 or 6 years ago, which I think is why, bringing it back to my earlier comments, why we might be entering into a zero-sum environment.
I'll just say a couple of words on the Australia-India economic relationship. I think it's going to follow a very, very different model to the Australia-China relationship. I think with bilateral trade numbers, currently India's the 10th most significant trade partner for Australia after Malaysia. And although that will likely climb, I don't think there is really any indication to believe that India will become another China for Australia. I think the India will resist the globalisation much more than China, and it will retain its trade barriers for quite some time. So I think that doesn't mean the relationship won't be close, but I think it'll be a very different type of relationship than we currently have with China.
Thank you very much, Matt, and thank you to the panellists for I think that really bracing session. And I should just add that those gifts are in fact a special investment in cyber invulnerability. They are pens, and very good, very very resistant to hacking. Look, I would just say that it's been a really useful day from what I've observed. I want to give maybe just a few reflections from myself and from a few colleagues here at the National Security College on the day we've been through today, and perhaps where this conference might lead, the contribution that it might make. It seems that as the day has gone on, we've really warmed up, just as it's warmed up outside, as you'll discover, I think, when you step outside. But I think after a little initial diplomatic politeness, understandably, I think we moved on to some very frank exchanges of views on the difficult intersection between domestic political uncertainty and the strategic environment. I think if that's one theme that many of us will take away from today, it's that domestic international nexus, which for us is really redefining what national security is about and goes very much to the core mission of this college, but also poses really difficult challenges for policymakers, whether it's in defence policy or foreign policy or strategic policy more generally. How do we develop consistency and how do we maintain solidarity among allies and partners when the real uncertainties are very much within as well as without? I thought it was also useful and welcome that we heard from some really significant emerging voices in the strategic and policy debates in a number of countries in the region, as well as very established voices, established players. So to hear from people with very distinguished and senior policy experience, I think was of course worthwhile, but to also have some of the emerging insights, particularly into, for example, the Philippines and India, I think was especially valuable as well. I think one of the challenges that certainly a few of my colleagues and I have taken out of today is this idea, which I think Gordon articulated for us, about democracies and allies being on the defensive for the time being, but also a very clear call, a very clear recognition that this is not a council of despair. This is about really, as we say, don't panic but don't relax. It's about resilience. It's about building and maintaining and defending the rules-based order that we've all contributed to. The going is getting tough for democracies. The going is getting tough for those countries that want to maintain a multipolar order in the Indo-Pacific, but the game has just begun in many ways. So I think in some ways there were some oddly reassuring notes that we heard from the conversation today. And of course, the focus on practical cooperation, I think the contributions from colleagues like Grant Newsham and from Ross Babbage and others who were really pointing to some of the practical things that Australia, Japan and others can do together and some creative ideas, for example trilateralising amphibious cooperation, that work we hope will continue on the surface and below the surface, despite a lot of the political challenges of the short term. Now, some of you, particularly some of the policymakers in the room, will be joining us tomorrow morning for a closed session with some of our visiting speakers where we'll get into these issues in perhaps a little bit more detail. And I'm sorry I can't invite everyone to the closed session, but I guess it wouldn't be a closed session if we did. The good news is that we have dinner this evening where, as our guest speaker, we have Sir Angus Houston, former Chief of the Australian Defence Force and someone who's career has very much intersected with the alliance with the United States and with Australia's security ties with Japan as well, and I believe we'll have a good opportunity for really carrying on the dialogue informally over drinks and at dinner and indeed with our dinner speaker. So really, I don't have a lot more to say. I want to thank all of you for coming here today. I want to thank our friends at the Japanese Embassy for their partnership and support in the wider project that this conference is indeed a part of. You'll be seeing more publications from the National Security College flowing from this event in the months to come, including a report that a few of us are putting together on particularly the Australia-Japan security relationship and how it intersects with these other relationships in the room. We encourage you all to really stay connected with what we do at the National Security College, in addition to conferences like this, which are part of our really expanded program of engagement with policy. We are, of course, a provider of training and education, and it seems to be that there's never been a better time to study national security, I have to say, than at present. So please think of us in all of those contexts, and please remain friends and contacts of the college. I just want to add one little housekeeping note before we close. There'll be buses leaving for dinner at 6 o'clock, just outside. On Liversidge Street. So you've got a few minutes to, I guess, gather your wits and relax before we head off to the dinner. Again, I want to thank all of our speakers, especially those who've travelled long distances from the United States, from Japan, and elsewhere in the region to really have this very dynamic conversation. I know there's already a little bit of interesting media coverage emerging, and a few of you will find yourselves quoted in the press, but I'm sure it's all accurate, and I'm sure it's not fake news. On that note, I think we can say that proceedings are at an end, so please join me in thanking the organisers, Chris Farnham and his team, and the speakers. Thank you.